Metal Faithful. It is I, your mandated reporter, and frankly, I'm mortified, Mr. Mark Rattledge, and this is the Metal Hammer of Doom. Tonight, we are reviewing a new Avatar album. Yes, Avatar released their 8th studio album, Hunter Gatherer, on August 7th, 2020. From the studio Spinroad in Lindome, Sweden. IKEA's from Sweden. I like meatballs. Licking his lips. Look at his chops. In the background there is my cohort, my partner in crime, my brother from another mother, my hetero life mate. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesse Starcher, how do you do, sir?
Mark Rattledge, buddy. I am ready to talk some Metal, some Avatar, returning from Avatar Country.
Avatar Country!
Oh, man. I had to listen to that album at least once today in order to remember where we have ventured from going into this new one. So, yeah, man, I'm excited to talk about this new Avatar album.
Did you ever hear the Avatar album that got me into the band, which was Hail the Apocalypse?
I have not. I know the song.
Okay.
I don't know what else is on the album and what it sounded like. I wanted to reach back and kind of listen to that today, but I never did. Because there's a lot of people that will say that that is
the pinnacle of Avatar.
Yeah. That was one of the best albums that they put out.
Yeah. I mean, I think I've told the story. I heard Avatar Country when I was cleaning up the not Avatar Country. I've heard Hail the Apocalypse while I was cleaning the house, and I had on like iTunes radio, and the whatever, you know, like you do with Spotify, like you do Pandora, any of these internet radio stations, you put one band in and it finds bands that are like it. And I was just, you know, dusting and sweeping and everything else, and all of a sudden I heard this bomb song, and I've been a fan of the band ever since. Problem is, they haven't released anything nearly as good.
Yeah.
Remind the people. Now, you were a big fan of Avatar Country. I'm not the hugest fan of concept albums. I think some concepts work better than others, and not all concepts are equal. And Avatar Country was a silly album, but you really liked it. Just kind of 50 words or less, your thoughts on Avatar Country.
Sure, yeah. It was my first introduction to actually listening to a full album by Avatar, and it was a lot of fun. I mean, if you listen to the concept album, it's talking about this fake kingdom where there's all sorts of silliness and just over-the-top absurdity happening. I mean, one track is just nothing but about the king who gets up to all his followers. There's fireworks. There's all sorts of great hoorah going on in this kingdom because the king took a bath and his enema went well.
Listen, so I wish people would celebrate my enemas and how well they go.
Oh, man. So, it was just a fun album, and it was done very well, in my opinion.
All right. Well, they released 3 singles from this album, Silence in the Age of Apes, which, believe it or not, that song was said to be inspired by a book by Yuval Noah Harari called Sapiens, A Brief History of Humankind.
Yeah, we're covering that on Source Material next week.
Yeah, sure. Source Material, the novels. you ain't covering shit on Source Material.
At least let me get away with one lie here.
And then on June 11th, they released God of Sick Dreams. Sick Dreams, yo.
Sick, bro.
And then straight out of the Xavier School for Gifted Youngsters, Colossus, July 9th, 2020.
That works.
So I'm going to be straight up. Now tell me, do you really want to love me forever? Mm. I'm going to be straight up and honest. Both of us have listened to this album. I don't know how many times you listened to it. I gave it at least 2 listens. And it's fine. It's not as good as Hail the Apocalypse, but it's better than Avatar Country, in my opinion. You know, at least it's got some jams on there. This has to be kind of a short show tonight, so we're gonna medley 3 at a time. I don't know how people feel about that. If people prefer when we discuss each track, but I'm telling you right now, there's not a lot to discuss on each song. And I think that's what, you know, Jesse and I have learned over doing the show over the course of a few years now, that when there's not a tremendous amount to say about the album, it's not great to do it track by track, because then one of two things happens. We either just start bullshitting and telling stories.
That is a high probability if that occurs.
And I don't have the stamina to do a 3-hour Jesse and Mark bullshit session, and I don't know if people even enjoy that sort of thing. So you can tell me one way or the other, either through Facebook or Twitter, Mark Rattledge, LCSW on Facebook, and Mark Rattledge on Twitter, and tell us, you know, you like the bullshit sessions or you don't. But either way, tonight, because of how I'm feeling, and because of the album itself, a combination of both things, we're just going to medley 3 songs, talk about them, medley another 3, and we're going to get through these 10 songs pretty quickly. So that's the story. It may sound glory. Don't ever try to gamble in another man's territory.
Yeah, that's almost exactly where I was going to go.
That's a Fat Boy lyric right there that
nice.
I just dropped.
Digging deep.
Yeah. That's the moral of the story. It may sound gory. Don't ever try to gamble in another territory. Stupid. Don't nice. Be stupid.
Very nice.
44 years old and I'm still busting out Fat Boy raps.
It's been a while since I heard the Fat Boys.
Some people on this show listen to the show, like, is he calling himself fat? Who the Fat Boys? What the fuck are the who? What?
Oh,
where are my
wow.
pants?
Oh, goodness. All right, man, let's rock and roll. Let's hit these first 3.
Yeah, buddy, here we go. The first 3 tracks on here are going to be Silence in the Age of Apes, Colossus, and A Secret Door.
We'll be right back.
right, three songs, three very different songs.
Yeah.
That last one's like 6 minutes and 7 seconds long. First of all, Silence in the Age of Apes I thought was dope. Mm-hmm. That's the jam right there. Good. And I was kind of hoping we'd get more of that. Then we get a very different song in Colossus, kind of a goth industrial type mix. And then A Secret Door. I know you want to talk about A Secret Door. I know you. I walked with you once upon a dream. I know A Secret Door spoke to you because there's a story going on there.
There's a story going on all over this album. It's not all connected, but there is a lot of content that went into the development of these songs. Which, by the way, the whistling you're hearing is Corey Taylor. He actually makes a few appearances on this album. One of which was in one of which is in Colossus. He I think he contributed to some of the shouting vocals, and then in Secret Door, that's Corey Taylor whistling. So I'll just read Johannes, his background for Secret Door here. This is via Apple Music.
Hang on 1 second. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Little old lady.
Little old lady who. Little old lady who.
I didn't know you could yodel.
Oh, my goodness.
Go on with Johan now.
This song was a whistling melody that was inspired in part by Ennio Morricone and in part by a Swedish guy called Björn Olsson, who is basically an indie pop fellow that has done a lot of light, pleasant, summery tunes with whistling on them. And we got Corey Taylor from Slipknot to do the whistling. Thematically, it's about all hope being lost. This is a very... I'm cutting into the quote here. This album is very dark and depressing when you get into the lyrics. Just about every single song that we're going to hear tonight, if you really pick apart the lyrics, there's either some type of oncoming apocalypse or some type of threat or some type of depression that you're having to try and go through that is in the element of just about every single one of these songs. So back to the quote here. He says, it does move more in the plane of relationships when things might look really dark, but you try until the bitter end and see something crash and burn completely instead of giving up along the way. Or like going out to the front line of battle, knowing you're going to die there, but you've chosen your hill to die on, which would be the secret door that you keep hoping for, the way out of the situation. So, man, you know, I'm right there with you, Mark. We listen to these first three songs. We come in with a banger, in my opinion, with Silence in the Age of the Apes, which is, by the way, the first song that I had the opportunity to hear when I was out doing something, and I had Spotify going, and I was like, oh crap, is this from the new Avatar album? Sure enough, it was. So that was the first song that I got to hear off this album. Colossus is like this lumbering tune, man, and when it gets going, at first I was like, I thought it was a rap song the way that it starts out. And you mentioned goth industrial, yeah, definitely, but it just starts, it starts out as this lumbering heavy tune that just keeps coming at you. And then we talked about Secret Door. It's laid back. Three very different songs to start this off. Not as cohesive and fun as Avatar Country in any way, but either way, you know, they weren't horrible songs. I'll listen to them. This isn't something that I'm immediately turning off.
No, they were all imminently listenable, just very, very different. And I don't, you know, placement, we talk about placement with records, tracks on a record. I don't know if you want to go so early into tracks like Colossus and A Secret Door. I guess we'll have to hear the rest of the album and determine, you know, was this the right mix of songs in the right order, or maybe could they have saved some of these for later on in the album. On the other hand, you know, we also talk about songs being top heavy or bottom or back heavy. We'll have to see. Well, obviously, I'm not sure how sold I am either way.
Okay. All right. Well, let's hear the next three.
All right. So the next three songs are God of Sick Dreams, Yo, Scream Until You Wake, and Child.
so loud when the casket hit the ground that the tiny bell that rang was all but drowned. She's buried alive. It's not right to lose one's mother while so young. The child was wondering still that if mother was so ill, then who pulled on the strings so the bell rung? She's buried alive.
See, we got three really heavy songs there.
Yep. Three right in a row.
Yep. Kind of progressive sounding, kind of very modern metal, especially Scream Until You Wake. That's like right out of the hardcore subgenre. The way that they broke that,
it felt down. Very normal.
Yeah.
out of the rest of these songs, that's probably the most normal song you're probably going to hear.
And what's funny is it's one I really like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I hate to be the guy that's just like, you know, I only like this kind of metal, because I think I've said on here any number of times there's stuff that I can appreciate that might not be directly in my wheelhouse, but you know, you like what you like, and I could easily take any one of these three songs over Colossus or A Secret Door.
Really?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay. All right. So God of Sick Dreams, which as I was listening to it and seeing the title, I was like, is he actually talking about fever dreams? Because, man, you have some messed up dreams when you're sick sometimes.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that you probably experienced that here recently. But, yeah, he has... He actually went on to say that this is about how nightmares are created by yourself. Like he was amazed at the fact that he had this like really screwed up apocalyptic dream over and over and over.
Mm-hmm.
And he realized that it was himself that was creating this. So that's kind of what went into God of Sick Dreams. Scream Until You Wake. I could read off here. Louder Sound says that, I think they talked to Johan about what went into this one. He says it's just another existential dread song. It's about trying to find your place, and I'm not trying to wake you up. You have to wake yourself up before it's too late. And then Child. Okay, so this is the one song off of this album lyrically that kind of got to me. Okay, if you listen to the lyrics, it does tell a story about this kid. And while I was listening to it, I was picking up that this kid's mom passes away. And this is back in like the 18th or 19th century. And have you ever seen pictures of like how they used to tie? No. They used to tie.
Is like, it pictures of Lily?
Oh my gosh.
Sorry,
they used to tie strings. They used to tie strings to the toes of people who pass away, and when they would go and bury them, if the string would lead to a bell, and if the bell rang, they knew that they had to dig the person up because the person was still alive. They didn't understand the completeness. I don't know if that's a word. The finality of death at that point. So in order to make sure, they were just like, okay, well, we're going to tie a rope to their toe, and that way...
What a horrible existence.
Oh. Like,
bring, I'm not dead. Bring, well, I want to go for a walk.
This song, the way this song goes is that the child watches their mom apparently pass away,
mm-hmm.
and they bury the mom, and there's a choir singing during the funeral, And the bell rings and nobody hears it other than the kid because the choir's so loud.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, oh, man, this is getting dark. Well, there's a lot more to it when you look at the what went into creating the song. I think there was this is a dark, depressing album. And they tout that, too. It's not like they're coming out and saying, hey, guys, check out our album. You know, it'll make you feel good. No,
this is not Hatebreed.
No, this is not positivity. This is like, you know, there's something to worry about with just about every song. So Child, when I was listening to that, the lyrics kind of got to me. And I mean, I like the song. Out of these three, I would probably lean with Scream Until You Wake. God of Sick Dreams, man, I can't talk tonight. God of Sick Dreams kind of annoys me every once in a while when I'm listening to it, but it's not horrible. Mm-hmm. So there you go. There's my thoughts on the three.
All right, well, this is 10 songs. We didn't cut anything tonight, and there are 4 songs left, so we got a little bit longer medley to get through. All right. The following songs are Justice, Gun, When All But Force Has Failed, and Wormhole.
Just one last time.
You know, if he had had like a deeper voice and growled differently, I could have sworn that was a typo negative song.
Yeah, I can see where you're going there.
All right, so Justice is the fucking jam.
You like Justice, all right.
Yeah, this whole album needed to be Justice.
There's some stuff that kind of resembles that. Like, you played what you just listened to. The second to last song was called When All But Force Has Failed, and I thought that was probably one of the faster, heavier tunes off of here as well.
Oh, yeah, you don't have to think it is.
It's good. It's good stuff. But yeah, man, so what are you thinking?
I mean, the whole album is fine. I said at the top of the show, I kind of gave away the ending of this podcast. I think it's a solid album. I'm not gonna grade it lower because some of the songs were not my
all balls out.
Yeah, my speed. I think they did an admirable job of not making it samey.
One of the biggest, yeah, that's for sure. One of the biggest, like, one of the most glaring songs that almost feels like it doesn't fit. But it's on here is Gun, which is the one that was slow and nothing but vocals and piano.
Right.
Have you ever heard an Avatar song like that before?
I'm not really the one to ask because I've only heard Hail the Apocalypse, Avatar Country, and this one.
I'm not saying, you know, of their discography. Just I'm saying of what you've heard.
Not of what I've heard, but then I haven't heard everything.
Okay. All right. Yeah, and that's it. It's emotional. It's only piano and vocals, and it's just, I'm not going to give it crap because I understand the artists.
You know, I had this problem with one of the Slipknot albums where I want to say it was like either the third or fourth one where it was like, what's great about Slipknot is how fast and how heavy and how angry they are. And then they would do these like light piano numbers, and it was like, come on, man.
Yeah, what? Why? Why are we doing this?
What the fuck are we doing here? Here's where
I was going to say, speaking of Corey Taylor, he provided in that final song, Wormhole, mm-hmm. he provided the pre-chorus, the part you played right before you cut it off. They were trying to put this stuff together and they're like, man, what can we do? They reach out to Corey Taylor yet again. He comes up with this pre-chorus for the song and
they almost made a typo negative song.
This metal chemistry, I don't understand.
I'm going to go ahead and give it a B+.
Okay. All right.
Do you got some notes there on what some of the other reviewers thought?
Yeah, I listened and watched a couple reviews today. Shout out to the guys over at Two Toe Tags Metal Reviews. They kind of do something similar to what we do, where we listen to an album, you know, more than a few times, and then come on here and talk about it. And usually they go track by track, talk about criticism, blah blah blah. Well, one of the things that they pointed out, which after listening to what they said and listening to the album again, it is very obvious. There are 6 out of 10 songs on here that have very long outros. Like, it just kind of winds down. And he said it's like near 30 seconds for each one of these songs where the outro just kind of keeps winding down. He's like, you right there, that's 3 minutes you could have cut off this album. I'm not saying this album is, you know, overly long.
I was going to say, like, it clocks in at 45 minutes.
No, it's not overly long, but... there's something to be said about padding. We talk about that a lot when it comes to movies and TV and just throwing shit in a comic, you start to wonder, like, are they using that as a padding mechanism just to kind of, like, pad the album length?
These guys are kind of avant-garde metal, and I don't know if I would levy that criticism against them. I think what they do is purposeful. It may not be... It may not be enjoyable, but I think for them, they have a... That's one thing about this album. That's why I'm not, like, heavily criticizing it. Everything about this album feels purposeful. Everything has its place. This is meaningful to these guys. They did not just record an album to get an album out there so they could go out and tour. Like, you can tell this was carefully laid out and carefully produced to be a certain thing, you know, to meet a certain criteria to be a certain thing. Mm-hmm. That comes through with each song. So if they did these overly long outros, I think that was done purposefully for effect.
Yeah, yeah. And let me go ahead and say that this album does check some boxes for me. Avatar does a fun mix of clean and harsh. You know I'm a fan of that. This album is not fun, but that's not what it set out to be. The song Gun, which is the one I just talked about, just being piano and vocals, they said that was a song that was 7 years in the making because they would continue to add parts to it, try to put it on an album, and it didn't fit. So this is probably the best album for that song to go on. I'll agree mm-hmm. with that. Definitely not samey. I mean, these songs do vary in structure. They vary in length, and they vary in speed versus being slow. It's an okay mix. I'm looking for something that's more upbeat. That's why I felt when I come into this, you know, I'm coming off of Avatar Country, and I'm like, oh man, I cannot wait. This is going to be such a fun album. I didn't realize that, you know, hey, we're going to take you from happy, fun times into the depths of despair, and that's kind of what we got. It was a complete 180. Mm-hmm. But either way, I enjoyed the album, man. So you're going to go with, for your song, you're sticking with
Justice.
Justice. All right. Well, I'm putting Wormhole on there. That was my favorite off of here. It was a toss-up between that
Neither one of us picked a single.
Which one? What you talking about, the first one, which was...
Any of the three singles. Neither one of us picked them.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I Silence in the Age of the Apes is okay. Colossus is... What was the third one?
God of Sick Dreams.
No way.
Yeah, that was kind Colossus. Of a meh for me.
Colossus is probably the best of those three, in my opinion. But there you go, Mark. That is Avatar Hunter Gatherer.
Yes, it is. Next week on the Metal Hammer of Doom, we will be reviewing the new Carcass album, Torn Arteries. Jesse loves the death metal, so that'll be fun.
Mm. When is Unleash the Archers happening?
At about a month from now, September 16th.
Okay. All right.
We got
At least I'll have that album. I'll have that album to kind of hang on to while I'm trying to get through Carcass.
Well, it's funny you mentioned that because after Carcass, we're taking a 2-week break because we got some movies we got to deal with, and there's just no room in the schedule for a Metal Hammer of Doom.
It's going to take me 2 weeks to take a shower to get Carcass off of me.
We went from no movies to all the movies at once. So it's like New Mutants and Bill and Ted are coming out on the same day. Tenet and Mulan come out the same week. So it was like...
Whew, yeah, that sounds like fun.
Yeah, baby. Indeed.
So,
so we've got a 2-week break, and then we'll have Unleash the Archers, then another week break, and then it's all covers all month long in the month of October, Jesse. You got BPMD, not EPMD, that's a rap group. This is BPMD, American Made, and that's a covers album. John Damian, These Gray Men, that's a covers album. Yorn, Heavy Metal, Heavy Rock Radio, Volume 1, and then Heavy Rock Radio, Volume 2, Executing the Classics. That's the 14th and the 21st. And then we're going to end covers month all month long with Danzig Sings Elvis.
Mm-hmm.
Been waiting for this one for like 2 years now.
Mm.
Yes,
man,
sir.
Oh, man. Man, oh, man. I can't believe October's like right around the corner.
Tell me about it.
Jeez.
My last two treatment days are the 28th and the 29th of September. I get to go through the whole month of October and not have to go see the doctor. Isn't that great?
That is spectacular. Spectacular.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And then I have a PET scan in November. Hot diggity.
D-zam.
Yes, sir. All right. In the meantime, in between time, myself and Alexis Haina reviewed the first season of Upload on Amazon Prime. Myself and Chris Sheehan reviewed Avengers No Road Home, and we tore a new asshole into Mark Waid and Al Ewing. Goodness gracious.
I haven't had a chance to listen to that, but I have a feeling of what I'm going to get into.
Chris Sheehan got in his feelings on that one, man.
Oh, man. Oh,
he had
man.
Some shit to say to Al Ewing. He said, fuck you and your birds.
That's great.
Next week, we'll have a Damn You Hollywood for the one and only Ivan that's now a Disney Plus exclusive. We'll have a review of SummerSlam, and we will be reviewing Carcass, as I said before. You can also check out myself and Robert Winfrey do a review of the Kentucky Fried Movie. I made him watch it, and then we talked about it. That was fun. Last week on the Metal Hammer of Doom, we reviewed a Clutch concert live from the Doom Saloon Volume 2. And Cole Marintet, who does not make many appearances on the Rattlesnake Broadcasting Network, deigned to spend some time with us to talk one of his favorite things, Transformers, The War for Cybertron, Part 1, Siege. So you can check out all that. Jesse, you ain't got shit to do and nowhere to do it, so...
That's correct. That is correct. All I'm doing is being essential and just podcasting whenever metal comes around. So hopefully at some point I'll be able to come back into the fold full time. Until then.
I got shit settled through December, and come January, man, you better come back.
Fucking talk to this virus.
talk to the virus. All right, thanks for hanging out with us here on the Metal Hammer of Doom, this abbreviated show. Maybe that's what people like. They're like, yeah, we don't need to hear an hour of you two. Cut it down. Be well, be safe, and cut it down.